Call the meeting to order for legislative session 2016-18, September 6, 2016. Those who'd like to stand and join us in the Lord's Prayer and Pledge of Allegiance, please do.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory forever. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to entertain a motion to approve legislative minutes from August 16, 2016.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any corrections? Seeing none. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Minutes are approved. Entertain a motion to approve the legislative minutes from August 23, 2016.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any corrections?
On the first page, it said that the president recognized Delegate Carol Anderson.
I think it's still Carl, yes. Any other corrections? Thank you, Councilman Dodd. Seeing none, all those in favor of legislative minutes from August 23rd, 2016 as corrected, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion is carried. Minutes are approved. And now we have a proclamation. Our executive, Bob Carver, is in the room tonight. Good evening, Bob.
Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate it very much. If I can, I'd like to have Reverend George Patterson, Mr. Roy Perdue, join me at the podium. Well, we'll do that as soon as we finish.
Okay.
If you'd like to join us, it'd be fine. Right. It's a great honor for me tonight to present this proclamation on behalf of the County Council and the Executive's Office to Trinity United Methodist Church. This year they are celebrating their 150th anniversary. That would be the sesquicentennial, right?
It would be, so, that's correct.
Yeah, that was a mouthful. But anyhow, so yeah, so we're very honored to do that. And actually, in conjunction with Wicomico County in 2017, we're going to celebrate 150 years also.
Wow.
So we'll join together later on. But I would like to read this proclamation if I could.
Hold on a second, Bob. Thanks.
No problem.
I like
Thank
the ringtone, but it's
In 1866, eight men and a teenage girl withdrew from the Salisbury Methodist Episcopal Church to form a new congregation. They were Henry Brewington, James Cannon, Levin J. DeShiel, Levin Dorman, William Gordy, Hugh Jackson, Isaac Jackson, and William B. Tillman and Miss Nanny Ryder. Established Trinity United Methodist Church, becoming the northernmost congregation of the old Southern Methodist Church. The church was reconstructed in three different times. The first chapel burned in 1885, but was quickly rebuilt. However, the Great Salisbury Fire of 1886 reduced Trinity Church to ashes. By 1887, the third building was erected and later became St. Francis de Sales Roman Catholic Church. In the early 20th century, the former Miss Nanny Ryder and her husband, Governor Jackson, became Trinity Church's benefactors, donating the present church. Trinity Church's mosaics in the sanctuary are true examples of the Louis Tiffany and are described in the history of the Tiffany windows. The present church was completed and dedicated on May 21st, 1905. In 1930, Mrs. Jackson presented to the Jackson Memorial Building to the church as a memorial to her husband. Over the years, many gifts, including nearby properties, have been given to Trinity Church by other members, including Mrs. Harry Palmer and the late Henry S. Parker and Nellie Parker. Today, the membership of Trinity Church has grown to over 1,700, making Trinity Church one of the largest worshiping congregations on the Eastern Shore. I, Bob Culver, and the County Council would like to hereby join in welcoming and celebrating the 150th anniversary of Trinity Church. We have two Pattersons in the audience tonight, and I would think we'd be better off with Reverend George than we would with Mark. So we're going to go with Reverend George.
On behalf of the members and friends of Trinity United Methodist Church, we'd like to thank our county executive and the county council for honoring us with this proclamation. Trinity is proud to have served the city of Salisbury and Wicomico County for 150 years. And we look forward to serving the city of Salisbury and Wicomico County for many, many more years to come. We'd like to invite the county council, Bob's a member at Trinity, and anybody in attendance tonight, we're going to celebrate this special moment in the life of our church on the weekend of September the 24th and 25th. On Saturday, September the 24th, we'll begin with a picnic-style supper. There'll be two seatings, 3 and 5, free tickets. All you got to do is call the church office. And then at 6 o'clock, we'll gather in the sanctuary for the sealing of the time capsule, and then a drama depicting the formation of this church. And then on Sunday morning, we'll gather for 3 worship services, 8, 9, 30, and 11. And we have special music by our sanctuary choir, also our children's choir. And our special guest speaker that day will be our district superintendent, who presides over 119 United Methodist churches in the Salisbury district, the Reverend Fred Duncan. He'll be delivering our message. So thank you again for this honor. We're privileged to be a part of this community, and we look forward to serving this community, this county, for many, many more years to come. God bless all of you.
Thank you. Did you get the picture?
I got it.
Okay, we're waiting.
All right.
Mr. Baker, good evening.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Notice was given in accordance with Section 3311D of the Charter that the Council would conduct a public hearing on an act to amend Wicomico County Code Chapter 141, titled Fees, Section 141-4, titled Department of Public Works, to add language adjusting the per-ton tipping fee for a state-permitted construction and demolition facility in Wicomico County to encourage recycling.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. At this time, we open the floor for Legislative Bill 2016-11. Anybody that would like to talk, comment on this legislative bill, please come to the podium, state your name, and your address. Did we have any signups on this? Okay. All right. That being said, this concludes the public hearing on Legislative Bill 2016-11. Excuse me. I have to, I think I have a correction on that, don't I, gentlemen? 2016-10. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Members of the County Council, ladies and gentlemen, next item for your consideration is Resolution Number 107, 2016, confirming the appointment of Patty Tingle to the Commission on Aging as an ex officio member of the Commission.
Entertain a motion to approve Resolution 107, 2016.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Next for your consideration is Resolution Number 108, 2016, confirming the appointment of Linda F. Hearn to the Commission on Aging as an ex officio member of the Commission.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 108, 2016.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Next is Resolution Number 109, 2016, confirming the appointment of Daniel Savoy to the Commission on Aging as a member and chairperson of the Commission.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 109, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Next is Resolution Number 110, 2016, confirming the appointment of Harry Basort, Ph.D., to the Commission on Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 110, 2016. Second?
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution Number 111, 2016, confirming the appointment of Bradley L. Bellachico to the Commission on Aging as a member of the Commission.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 111-2016.
Second.
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 Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Number 112-2016, confirming the appointment of Betty Jane Burdell to the Commission on Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 112-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Resolution number 104.
Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman. Okay. I didn't mean to preempt you there. Resolution number 114-2016, confirming the appointment of John Piper to the Commission on Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 114-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes. Did you skip 113, Mr. Kramer? Somebody said yes.
Well, I don't have it in my packet. Resolution number 113, confirmment. Well, that's, I have
no, 113.
Jane is Johnson.
This is Jane. Jane and Johnson.
Oh, excuse
Disney
me.
Family. There are two.
Yes. Resolution number 113-2016, confirming the appointment of Jane Piper to the Commission as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 113-2016.
So.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 115, no?
Yes.
Did we do John?
Yeah.
Wake up, Matt. Resolution number 115-2016, confirming the appointment of Tasha Robinson to the Commission on Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 115-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion is carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 116-2016, confirming the appointment of Cindy Robinson to the Commission on Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 116-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion is carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 117-2016, confirming the appointment of Kelsey Rose Jolly Gaddison Maddox to the Commission on Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 117-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 118-2016, confirming the appointment of Kim Richardson to the Commission on Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 118-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 119-2016, confirming the appointment of Jeffrey B. Scherer, RPH, FACA, to the Commission on the Aging as a member.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 119-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 120-2016, confirming the appointment of Pastor Sharon Sampson to the Commission on the Aging as a member of the Commission.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 120-2016.
So
second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 121-2016, confirming the reappointment of Robert Franklin to the Wicomico County Board of Electrical Examiners to serve as a representative of a local electrical utility company.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 121-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 122-2016, confirming the appointment of Rick Wheeler to the Wicomico County Board of Electrical Examiners to serve as a representative engaged in the electrical contracting business for a period in excess of 5 years.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 122-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 123, 2016, approving a priority level for the Maryland Department of Transportation fiscal 2017, fiscal 2022 Consolidated Transportation Program. Maryland Department of Transportation is in the initial stages of preparing the Consolidated Transportation Program for that period, and MDOT provides local governments with an opportunity to submit a priority letter containing the recommended improvements, capital expansion, and system presentation projects on the two state highways to be considered for inclusion. The county has worked with local incorporated municipalities and the Salisbury-Wicomico Metropolitan Planning Organization to identify potential priority projects to be included. The executive recommends the approval of the priority letter, and the priority letter must be endorsed by the county executive and the county council and the majority of the local legislative delegation before being submitted to MDOT.
Entertain a motion to accept resolution 123, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
I know Keith is here. We've had a couple of sessions on this. Any questions from council, discussion?
Yes, you had a work session on the priority letter previously.
Okay. All those in favor of resolution 123, 2016, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Resolution number 124, 2016, accepting certain subdivision streets as county roads for inclusion in the Wicomico County Road Inventory. The county code provides that those portions of land designated as subdivision plats as streets, roads, and other thoroughfares shall be considered irrevocably offered for dedication to the public. The Director of Public Works has certified that the following streets have been duly and properly graded, paved, and drained, and recommend that they be included in the county inventory for county maintenance. Those include Barbado Drive in the Plantation Subdivision and Cantor Drive in the Plantation Subdivision, and I believe there's a map showing the areas and the streets that are included.
Entertain a motion to accept resolution 124, 2016.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Mr. Weston Young, I know you're here, right? Weston, you come on up if you don't mind. Good evening. How are you?
Good evening. How are you all?
Doing great, thanks.
So these roads in the Plantation subdivision, this was a subdivision that was built during the bubble, and then I guess it changed hands several times. We met with the current owners and went over the current road subgrade conditions. They made significant improvements and brought them up to county standards. This includes a 3-year maintenance period, so should there be any faults in the design, we can handle it, or construction, we can go after it then. So these roads have been thoroughly inspected and meet our current regulations.
Okay. Questions from council?
Weston, does this include curbs and gutters?
Yes. Everything in the right of way, everything that the county would then maintain henceforth.
So when were the roads completed?
It was, I want to say May.
So just recently?
Yeah, it was recent, and okay. It's something that we worked to get it on the agenda shortly thereafter.
Because I know back in 2010, I believe, the time period was extended, wasn't it? I think from 2 years to 3, is that correct?
Yes.
Just to allow
the maintenance
for more assurances?
Period. Yeah, sometimes there was a time period, especially in 2008, when developments were everywhere, having inspectors there at all times. Mm-hmm. And once something's underground and paved over, it's hard to go back and determine if it was done properly. Going to 3 years helps identify if there's any faults in the subgrade or thickness of pavement, anything we could have missed.
Right. Okay. And that's sufficient?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so far.
Yeah. Any other questions? All right. Seeing none, all those in favor of resolution 124, 2016, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes. Thank you.
I am the next one, too.
Okay. Sit tight then.
Resolution number 125, 2016, approving an agreement between Wicomico County, Maryland and the town of Willards for the enforcement of erosion and sediment control within the corporate limits of Town of Willards and authorizing the county executive to execute the agreement.
I entertain a motion to accept Resolution 125-2016. Second.
Second.
Discussion. Just, you know, an overview would be great.
Yes, so this resolution is very similar to other ones we've brought before you recently. This formalizes our agreement with Willards that we will handle the erosion and sediment control review and enforcement. We have similar agreements for stormwater, and we do it for any, we're mandated by the state to fill in the gaps. So if a municipality is unable or uninterested in performing these reviews and enforcements, we step in and take care of that.
Okay. Any questions? All right, seeing none. All those in favor of Resolution 125-2016, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passed.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Resolution number 126-2016, to make an appropriation of funds to the Wicomico County State's Attorney's Office from contingency in the amount of $79,633.52. Mrs. Ella Disharoon from the State's Attorney's Office is here to answer any questions that you may have.
I entertain a motion from Council to accept Resolution 126-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Good evening.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you? This is Andrew Illuminati. He is a Senior Assistant State's Attorney at the office.
Please speak into the microphone.
Speak into the mic if you could, and you get a chance to introduce yourself to the public there. Thanks.
Good evening. May it please the Council, Mr. President. My name is Andrew Illuminati, Illuminati, and I've been an Assistant State's Attorney for Wicomico County for over 5 years now.
Good. Very good.
So, in December of 2016, the state is switching to electronic court system, which is called MDEC. It's mandatory. We don't have a choice. It's going to, everything court-wise is going to be electronically filed. Our current case management system won't support the new MDEC system because it's just too antiquated. Matt was working on this prior to his appointment as judge, but we had to go through a bidding process and all kinds of different things, which didn't allow us to get the system and the contract done prior to the end of the fiscal year 2016. So we are asking for contingency funds to be given back to us to purchase the system. We have been talking to Judicial Dialogue Systems. We did do a bidding process. They came in at the lowest price, but they are who we would have picked anyway, because for our needs, they offer the best system. I'm going to let Andrew speak a little bit on that because he's done all of the research with respect to the different case management systems.
Okay.
To truly understand why Judicial Dialogue Systems is in the best interest of the county, first we have to look at that is a Maryland-based company. And whenever the opportunity to do business with a Maryland-based company exists, it's something that improves the state overall. In researching the three main competitors for this process, I traveled to two separate state's attorney's offices. Frederick County, which is partially comparable to our size, has Judicial Dialogue Systems, and they've been working with them for 5 years. Additionally, Judicial Dialogue Services Systems is present in Baltimore City, I believe Prince George's County, Carroll County, and Washington County. So they are represented throughout the state already. Two other competitors, one was Carpel. That company is currently only located within Anne Arundel County. And the other was Software Unlimited. Software Unlimited went through a bidding process with the Upper Shore, who recently had MDEC installed in July. At the time of the bidding, I was unable to view Software Unlimited's interaction with the Upper Shore due to the fact that they had yet to install it. However, each of the companies, I sat through a presentation, met with the heads of the company, and allowed them to demonstrate their software. So even if I was unable to view it live in how it currently was interacting with a Maryland-based state's attorney's office, I was able to see their product and how they propose it would interact with both our office and MDEC as a whole.
So with MDEC, right now we file everything paper. We draft it, we print it out, and we walk it over to the courthouse. Everything will have to be electronically filed from now on. And the court is getting rid of UCS and CJIS, which are two of the systems that they currently use that we have access to. Once they're gone, we have to file criminal information, criminal indictments. So we go before the grand jury, they indict somebody, we present it to the court, but then we have to take the files back to our office and input them into the court system so that they actually show up. We won't have the capacity to do that without the case management system. So we would actually not function anymore without a new case management system. I spoke to a state's attorney in another jurisdiction late last week. They started MDEC Live in July of this year, and they did not go with judicial dialogue system. I didn't ask who they did go with, but he said it's been a nightmare. He said that they can't see when witnesses have been subpoenaed, so they're going into court blind, wondering whether or not when they present a case for trial, they don't know if their witnesses are going to show up or not. They're trying to get the court to allow them a view-only access to witnesses being served, and they don't even have that yet. So we're just trying to make sure that we can efficiently switch to MDEC in December of 2016.
Questions?
No.
How long has this company been, the software company been, in this program in particular, been in use?
There are two separate programs. There's the case management system, which is how we will internally track all of our cases. Currently, we have an access-based program, which provides less information than Maryland Case Search.
Well, what I mean is the program that you're buying, how long has that been an established program, program?
Mr. President, they are two separate programs. The case management system will interact with the MDEC system. And this is not a way of skirting your answer, they are two systems, but they work together. As far as the MDEC, judicial dialogue, we would be their first client for the MDEC. As a result of that, they are providing us the beta version gratis, so at no cost to the county taxpayers, as well as continual support and enhancement to make sure it interacts with the court system. Obviously, a company which already has an MDEC system could be preferable, but at almost twice the cost of MDEC, that company is now recuperating from their current client base. Whereas as the first company that will be using the MDEC software, they will then be able to sell it to all of their competing counties. And obviously Baltimore City is a very large contract for them, so they have a very big incentive to provide the best software possible out of fear of losing the Baltimore City contract. So the Wicomico County, this cost is for the case management system, which includes an MDEC portion, but all of the coding that they would otherwise have to do is being provided to us gratis.
Joe?
Well, this is no questions, but I just want to make clear that this is how important our contingency fund is, because we never know when the state's going to mandate something that's going to pop up and cost us $80,000.
We were trying to get it done before the end of the fiscal year, but we just couldn't get the bidding process completed before that. This also covers all of 2017. Uh-huh. So the cost that we're asking is for the entire fiscal year of 2017.
What's the recurring cost each year?
I have it. Council's indulgence.
Yeah, sure. While you're looking, I would just add that we don't like to micromanage. We find ourselves in a kind of an unusual situation where we are responsible for the taxpayers' dollars, and it comes to this table for a reason. I would be a little leery of a beta system, but you know, from me personally, I would leave it in your hands. I mean, you seem as if you've been reviewing it very carefully. I do understand the cost-saving measures that you're taking. So
you can provide that some other time.
I commend you for that. I just really hope that as a beta system, it's going to follow through with what our expectations are, and you feel confident in that.
Yes.
Okay.
Having seen their other product in action, I have, and as well as their incentives to provide the best product possible to then sell throughout the rest of the state, I am confident in their ability to provide this.
Okay. The maintenance portion?
$8,200 a year, Jeff.
$8,200 a year. Yeah, it's never cheap.
No.
And we should see cost savings through this program anyway.
Yeah. Well, you should, because our paper, anything paper should go down.
Right.
Because everything is going to be electronically.
Will you go back in previous cases and file those so they'll be online also?
I don't know exactly how they're going to do that. Yeah. Do you?
Traditionally, what has been done in other counties is they attempted to do that in Anne Arundel County, to go back through and re-log all of the past cases. It was too time consuming and the cost benefit was not there. So when an old case, such as through a post-conviction from say 1996 is opened, the court then uploads the file at that time. So we will continue to maintain our files and purge based on our internal policies as well as statutory requirements. However, there will be no need to go back and load a case which is adjudicated prior to December 11, 2016.
Okay. We may scan in our cases, though, mm-hmm. in our own system, because we have an issue with storage.
Yeah.
We have cases going back a long time. So we've been scanning them in and then downloading them on a CD.
Mm-hmm.
So it's easier for us to keep the CD and then go back later if we need it than it is to maintain boxes and boxes of all files.
Okay.
What is the term of the maintenance? You know, this $79,000 includes maintenance and training. How many years of training will they allow, and how many years of maintenance will they allow?
The maintenance is up to 5 years at this point. The proposed contract allows us to opt out at any point if we are unsatisfied with the system. After that, everything would be a cap price, as well as for support. One of the unique things about Judicial Dialogue is that this current year create a consortium to allow each of the participating counties to benefit from when one county requests a certain file, such as if Carroll County says we need a system which tracks our governor's warrants, and they're the first ones to say they want it, they will pay the out-of-pocket cost. However, with the next update, we would benefit because we are in the same consortium as Carroll County. However, because Carroll County paid for it, they would get it first. And additionally, they allow all of the member agencies to come together and say, this has been a new change in the law, we need this today, and then they will provide that as part of the package.
Okay.
Andrew, if I understand this, then the case management system is what the $80,000 basically is going through. The MDEC is the beta system, which will be covered through 2017. Do you have an estimate on cost after 2017?
They did provide that. One of the factors the yearly support raises 5% each year, and it caps after 5 years. And looking at that compared to the other companies,
5% of what?
5% of the cost for the 2017 support. So
okay.
They articulated in the proposal a 2017 support, and then it's 5% each year. And capping at 5 years.
Okay.
So in year six, the cost would be the year five cost.
I understand.
And it was the second least expensive of the bidders. However, it was only in second place by about $1,000.
Okay. Any other questions? Seeing none. All those in favor of Resolution 126-2016, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes. Thank you very much.
Next for Council's consideration is Resolution Number 127-2016, confirming the appointment of Lisa Campbell as Director of the Wicomico Partnership for Families and Children.
Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 127-2016.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Ms. Campbell, I know you're here. Did you have anything? Sure, if you like. How are you tonight?
Good.
Hi, good to see you. Come on up, Wayne.
Biscuit.
Usually, you know, as a new appointment, we like you to, you know, give us an idea of, you know, anything you'd like as far as where you were headed with the programs and things of that nature. So the floor is yours.
Okay. Well, with the local management board's new direction from the governor's office, we are creating a community plan based on gathering the needs that we have in the community from the voice of our residents, of our leaders in the community, our stakeholders, the family and child serving agencies, as well as focusing on the governor's four strategic goals for the children's cabinet, which are reducing childhood homelessness, childhood hunger, reducing the impact of incarceration on children, and connecting the disconnected youth, getting them to work and training them. And so that's what we, as a board, are working on now, and looking to further our impact on especially the two areas of reducing the impact of incarceration and disconnected youth.
Yeah, those are governor's priorities and the priorities of Wicomico County as well. I know I've been many meetings where that comes up over and over again on trying to address those concerns. Questions from council? Okay. Seeing none. Mr. Strasburg, did you want to add anything?
I would just simply say that Lisa has been our acting department head now since March. We think she's done a very, very good job, and we're very confident that that will continue. We believe she's a good appointment.
Great. Great. Thank you. Entertain a motion to approve Resolution 127-2016.
So moved.
Second. Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Yeah, we did. I know. I'm drawing a blank on it. All those in favor of Resolution 127-2016 say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next for Council's consideration is Resolution Number 128-2016, authorizing the County Executive to accept grant awards from the Federal Aviation Administration and Maryland Aviation Administration Airport Improvement Program and Special Airport Grant Program for the rehabilitation of the Terminal Building Baggage Handling System Project.
Thank you, Mr. Kramer. Entertain a motion to accept Resolution 128-2016.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Good evening.
Hello.
How are you?
Good evening, gentlemen. This is what you have before you is a resolution authorizing the acceptance of what will actually be three grants. The grant before you this evening is from the Federal Aviation Administration in the amount of $637,170 and pays a eligible portion of the rehabilitation, essentially the gutting and replacement of a 25-year-old baggage conveyor system in the terminal building, and of course replacing that with an all-new system, and also taking the Transportation Security Administration's baggage X-ray device and incorporating that into an inline checked baggage system. You're also approving three grants from the Maryland Aviation Administration, one of those grants which will closely follow this FAA grant is in the amount of 34,000 $8,898, and that covers a portion of the FAA's AIP eligible portion of this project. And then there's a considerable portion of this project that is not eligible for FAA money, and the Maryland Aviation Administration is making a second grant offer to cover some of that non-AIP eligible in the amount of $227,041. From local share, we will use $105,348 in passenger facility charges. Those are a $4.50 head tax that the airline imposes on all revenue departing airline passengers who remit that money back to us. We currently have a balance of over $448,000 in the PFC account. And we will also be using $75,681 from our A5 airport capital account. And that account has an operating balance right now of $85,000 in it. Total project cost, $1,080,138.
Okay.
A lot of numbers.
Any questions from council?
The system is over 25 years old. We are salvaging parts from one of the three conveyor belts to keep the other two operating. We will replace not only the checked luggage conveyor system, again, incorporating the TSA's equipment into that system, but we'll also be replacing the baggage claim belt in the terminal building, associated utility upgrades that are necessary for code, and also the construction of a small office. That's all included in the project.
Bob, again, just to make it a little bit simpler, the cost of the project is $1,080,000 or $80,000. The county's portion of that is how much?
$105,000.
So 10%, basically.
And I should clarify that portion is not coming from the general fund. Right. That portion is coming from the airport's enterprise fund. The other thing is that utilization of PFCs have to be approved by the air carrier who's at the airport. This was a very high priority for Piedmont.
Mm-hmm. Any downtime in doing the work as far as how they're going to coordinate that?
Obviously, Joe, there will be some downtime. The entire project is a 120-day project. The airline is well aware that for much of that time, they're going to be carrying bags back and forth from the ticket counter to the rear of the terminal building, where they do load the bags onto baggage carts and tugs that take them out to the aircraft. So they're aware of the downtime.
Who's going to incur that cost?
That's an employee responsibility. Okay. Piedmont Airlines will incur that cost.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Can't have any worse delays in Philadelphia.
Yeah, that's right.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of Resolution 120-2016 say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion's carried. Resolution passes.
Excellent. Thank you.
Brian. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. That's all I have for now.
Okay. Mr. Baker.
President, I offer for your consideration Legislative Bill Number 2016-11, enacted in Chapter 225 of the County Code entitled Zoning, dealing with poultry houses. You've already held a public hearing on the proposed legislation.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. Entertain a motion from Council to accept Legislative Bill 2016-11.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion.
Mr. President, I'd like, I think the substance of the bill, while I'll acknowledge is not perfect, I think is pretty good for right now. I do think we need to make one change. I wouldn't exactly say it's cosmetic change. It's a change to bring it into conformity with the county charter. According to Section 311G of the County Charter, it says that emergency measures shall be plainly designated as emergency bills, and we, I believe we've decided to make this an emergency bill. That's what it was introduced as.
Correct.
And since we've done that, the Charter says that the bill needs to contain, after the enacting clause, a declaration stating that emergency exists and describing the claimed emergency in clear and specific terms. Right now, that language in there is kind of boilerplate language. It just says, kind of borrows from the Charter and says necessary for the immediate preservation of the public health, safety, and welfare. That doesn't, I don't think that complies with the Charter. So I would make a motion to strike that boilerplate language and instead insert, after it be further enacted that this bill is an emergency measure, insert the language, an increase in the number of poultry houses has shown the inadequacy of current zoning rules for the preservation of the welfare of residents and farmers. The County Council finds it necessary to enact an emergency bill to set rules that will respect the right to farm in Wicomico County, but also take into account the need for greater separation from residences and the need to conform to the comprehensive plan in terms of where farms may be located. I believe that describes, you know, the greater detail, the reasons why we're doing this. So, again, it doesn't change any substance, doesn't change any, any setbacks, doesn't do anything like that. It simply, I believe, brings this bill as language into conformity with Section 311G of the Charter. So that's.
Thank you, Councilman Kilmer. That's a motion on the floor. Is there a second?
Second.
A motion is second. Any discussion on the amendment, please? Seeing none, all those in favor of the amendment as proposed, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion is carried. Amendment passes. Any other discussion in reference to Legislative Bill 2016-11?
There had been some discussion about transition areas being put back into this legislation, and although it's a little bit late to do that at this time, I think it's also important that we consider doing that. There have been some issues that have come up in the last week or two from the municipalities, and if we do this, I put the transition areas back in, what's required? Can you tell me, Mr. President, or shall we bring Keith Hall up or Jack Lennox to? Well, are you going to give me any help at all, or are you just going to look at me?
I think what we're looking at is putting some type of restriction in there similar to what we had in the Metro Corps.
Right.
That's really as far as I think it's been discussed. It hasn't really been discussed much as a council because we haven't had that proposed until, I'd say, more within the last couple of weeks. So we haven't had any formal discussion on it. But as I understand it, that's my take on it, Councilman Hall.
And so if we approve this bill, then that will not be in there and we'll have to amend it, is what we're saying at this point?
We'd have future work sessions and you know, come to a decision how we want to address it.
Is that what you would prefer?
I think we would need input from the municipalities.
Okay. All right. Can we go ahead and set it up as a work session after we're done with this legislation then?
Well, we can
discuss it.
We can certainly have a discussion on that.
Okay.
I'm open to that.
All right.
Councilman Dodd?
Yeah. Somewhere along the line, there was a disconnect between us and the municipalities. We didn't hear from them until after the public hearing. And their voice is very important. So, along with Councilman Hall there, I think I would like to suggest that we have possibly quarterly work sessions open to the municipalities, starting with an upcoming work session on the transition areas.
Okay, thank you, Councilman Dodd. Any other discussions? Seeing none, I will do a roll call vote on Legislative Bill 2016-11 as amended. All those in favor will begin with Councilman Dodd. Councilman Davis?
No.
Councilman Holloway?
Joe. Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Kilmer?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Resolution 2016-11 passes as amended.
Okay. Now, at this time, are we going to consider this for a work session? Would you consider?
We'll consider that when we get into the agenda meeting.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I have another issue that I'd like to talked about on the agenda meeting also.
Okay. Always available.
All right.
At this time, we open the floor for public comments. If you have any public comments, come to the podium, please. I believe, Mr. Kramer, you do have the list.
Yes, sir, I do. The first name on the list is Mary Ashanti.
Okay. Who's next, Mr. Kramer, so they can be ready?
The second name on the list is Charles Wright.
Okay.
The third name on the list is Pete Richardson.
Good evening, President Ashanti.
Mary Ashanti, and I'm president of Wicomico County NAACP, and I want to thank, a whole protocol had been established because I've completely forgot it.
You're okay here.
Okay. Councilman Davis, thank you for not voting for that legislation. We're concerned. To move on to something else, we're concerned about the change in the public comment section. I noticed that there was a change when you had the public meeting, and what I noticed today when we came in that we have to sign in, and correct me if I'm wrong, but we have to sign in if we want to speak, and we must sign in before the county council meeting starts. Is that going to be the procedure from now on?
Yes.
Okay. Were we given any warning that that was going to happen? Because there's some folks that came here tonight that did not have the understanding that that had changed. And I did not know that that has changed. So were we given any warning that this was going to be the procedure? And why is it being changed? I'm just concerned that I've always kind of seen Wicomico County Council as hopefully open and not restrictive, but now you're moving in a direction that's restrictive to getting input from the community. So we're concerned about that. And we hope that you will rethink this process because I don't think it's a good process. And I hope that you allow the folks that have come in speak since we were not, perhaps you did make us aware and I just didn't know. I think I'm probably not the only one.
No, you're correct, President Sean. I appreciate you bringing that to our attention. It probably should have been noted on the agenda that was published online so that people could have seen that ahead of time. I agree with you.
But not only on the agenda, because everyone does not look at the agenda. Even the meeting before this, whatever, but let's not get so restrictive that the community see you as antagonistic. Let's not move in that direction. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening. Charles Wright, President of Wicomico County Farm Bureau. First, thank Councilman Kilmore for changing the language. And then I'd like to thank everybody for your vote to adopt it. It's a long process. We still got some time to go. But the Farm Bureau, we represent about 400 voting members and about just shy of 1,000 Farm Bureau members just in Wicomico County. The chicken industry is very important to us. I think the community has made concessions on both sides, and I just want to applaud your efforts and can look forward to continue working with you.
Thank you, Mr. Wright. I think
Mr. Richards, Pete Richardson.
He passed.
Thank you. Elisha and Dorothea Jones.
Would they be outside maybe? Okay, thanks.
Hi, my name is Doretha Jones, and the only comment that I want to make is from the meetings that I have attended, it seems to be a misconception. It appears to me that one group feels that one group does not want chicken houses in Wicomico County. That's not what we are talking about. I'm a product of a farm person. I grew up on a farm and I do love chickens. The problem is we're not against chicken houses, but it's the location. Of all the places that we have, all the farmland, all the vacant places, we just don't want chicken houses in our neighborhood. And that's the misconception.
Thank you.
Doris Jones. And Naomi Lee. And Lee Richardson.
I'd like to thank you for adopting the new rule. And also like to, for the future transition areas discussion that that is made very well public, you know, that some of these towns, you know, it's not just one person that you're going to affect. It's many of us that are in the transition areas that own farmland. So, you know, it does concern us on value and things like that. And we dealt with that years ago with housing. Everybody said we were going to devalue their lots because they couldn't build as many houses. Well, you're going to devalue our properties by changing this. So I want you to seriously consider it and hope keep us informed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Lee Richardson?
That was Lee Richardson,
I'm sorry. Did Doris Jones and Norma Lade?
Yes, Mrs. Jones was before Mr. Richardson.
Someone Church?
Either Mr. or Mrs. Church?
I can't make out the writing. I think it's Church.
Okay, move on, Mr. Kramer. We'll move
Thank
on
you.
And then
Margaret Barnes. She was just here.
Okay.
Hi.
Good evening.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I for those who are new in this room, I've been at most of these meetings, and so what I'm going to read is sort of a culmination of everything. I have been very concerned about the air quality from chicken CAFOs, especially ammonia and particulate matter, which, as we're discovering through more and more studies, is extremely detrimental to our health. It affects our asthma. It affects cardiovascular disease. It affects lung cancer, lung disease. It's a serious threat. It has CAFOs, as they emit these toxins, have no place in dense populations. Unless you put filters on the fans, which I have addressed many, many times, and I still haven't had any acknowledgement of that. Dear councilmen, when concerned citizens against industrial CAFOs, Wicomico NAACP and Moms Across America met with the Wicomico Health Department to discuss the health impact assessment. I didn't expect them to be able to defend their lack of scientific data, and I was right. After all, they only cited 16 references, 3 from the same opinion piece. When we questioned them on their pathetic lack of research, they said, well, this was a rapid health assessment. For those of you who don't know what a rapid health impact assessment is, It is only used in cases of emergency when time is of the essence, like Hurricane Katrina, for instance, not for the potential health crisis related to an industrial capo that hasn't even been built yet. It was a complete misuse of power by the health department, and I suspect with the blessing of our executive. anyway, the fact that they did not preface this HIA as a rapid health assessment is misleading and deceitful to the people of Wicomico County. Moreover, they consciously never contacted the one person who fought for this health impact assessment, Mr. Ed Lee. And thank you, Mr. Lee. At no time, even after many in our coalition requested a health ordinance and were told it was out of their hands, they slapped together this sham of a report. And now it's being passed around other counties in DPI's sites like it is the word of God himself. Had they done any real research on their HIA, they would have discovered, as I had, that the citations were not based in science. One of those references even included a personal statement in a phone call. In fact, most of the references in the HIA can be traced back to opinion pieces or, as council loves to point out, irrelevant to poultry. Because, as we all know, the ammonia from poultry is completely different than the ammonia from pigs or cows. That also goes for hydrogen sulfide, nitrates, viruses, bacteria, and particulate matter, according to the wisdom of County Council. The Health Department, after much pressing, did admit that the only real difference between cow, pig, and poultry manure was the water content. Somehow, this does not make me feel better. Council wants to have hard data on poultry to determine zoning that protects people's health. You want to follow DPI's good neighbor policy? Why? Where is their scientific data? And please do not condescend to waive those stupid extension studies from Dan Cunningham. They are not studies. My father taught me to be respectful of people, especially in esteemed public positions. But through this whole ordeal of presenting a real danger to public's health, you have chosen willful negligence, not just ignorance, negligence, which is frankly as bad, if not worse. Your hypocrisy and inability to hold the poultry industry accountable has proven to me that you do not care about the health of the people you have been entrusted to protect. I, along with others, will now be turning to the state and national levels to curb the abuses perpetrated by this insidious $8 billion industry whose disregard for human beings is so blatant that they won't even put filters on the fans, claiming that they can't afford them. Give me a break.
Mr. Kramer?
There are no other names on the list.
As President Ashanti stated, we appreciate what her concerns were. If there's anyone that would like to speak, the floor is open, so you can come to the podium if you don't mind. State your name and your address, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm standing on behalf of the Watching with One Voice on tonight. Our president could not be here, Pastor Watson, but I'm here tonight because also we are located in the same area. And as was mentioned before me, I'm definitely not against chickens. We love chickens. It's just that we're concerned about the location that they're being placed, and because of the different things that are created in the environment with people who have asthma, such as my wife, she's an asthmatic, and others who have chronic conditions. And we're concerned about those things that affect us as we're in and out of the, you know, in the area for church and people living in the area. So we are very much concerned about that, and we pray that something will be done to make it right and in this last time. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Okay, seeing that concludes the public hearing, or public comments, I'm sorry. At this time, we open the floor for council comments. Mr. Kilmer?
Mr. President, I I guess I would say to Mrs. Ashanti that I kind of agree with her. I don't mean to disagree with you, Mr. Cannon, but I'm not in favor of the sign-up process. I do think it should be should be open, and I think we're a little rocky happening tonight with some of the names and the sign-ups and things like that. I mean, going back to our old way of doing things would suit me fine. I understand why we did it for the larger public hearing, in terms of, you know, something where there's a big interest in the poultry issue public hearing. For most of our meetings, though, I don't know that it's it works very well. So I'll register my respectful disagreement with that, and think let's just go back to the way we did things of old. To respond to some of the concerns about the locations of chicken houses, in this legislation, the attempt was to place severe restrictions on chicken houses in residential areas and land that's zoned residential. Having to go through the special exception process for a chicken house is one that I think would be an effective ban in almost all land zoned residential. If you look at the special exception process, only in rare instances could that even could a chicken house even be built under that system. And if it was, it would be stricter regulations than in the ag district. So that was an attempt to address the concerns that many had that it wasn't anti-chicken, but was the placement of chicken houses. This legislation isn't perfect legislation. I don't know anyone who's happy with it. I know people who are not, you know, unhappy, which is maybe the best that we can do with legislation. And I recognize that it did cause division in the community. But speaking as someone who a year ago didn't think we needed any new regulation, we went from literally one line in the zoning code on poultry houses to six pages of zoning regulations on poultry houses, which is fairly significant. So there are other issues out there, as Councilman Hall talks about, in terms of town transition areas. I do think that probably will be looked at, and I do support your work session idea on that. So you know, going forward, that's something that I guess we'll be looking at. But I just wanted to express what I think we were attempting to do with this legislation, the attempt to deal with the residential area and some greater separations and things like that. So that was the attempt. Again, I don't know if anyone's real happy about the bill, but you know, if we can get people to you know, start moving forward from this date forward with the new rules, I think that will be an improvement in this county.
Thank you, Councilman Kilmer. Any other council comments?
I think that it, like you said, it did divide the community, the county. I think what we should do, if it's possible, from now on, get the two sides together and let them sit down and talk out their differences among them and then bring it to us. I think it should be best if they decide what's best. If they get two groups together from DPI and the residents of the county, and then maybe a neutral party, to sit down with these groups together and come up with some solutions, because this is not going to be the end of it. There's going to be an ongoing thing, and I think that's the way we got to get this community back together. And like you said, I did vote against it, but it's not our vote against chicken houses per se. But I think that this thing was, I don't think it was done properly. I think more input should have been done from the community. We should have done a study of our own of Wicomico County instead of getting these studies from Georgia or wherever. We don't live there. Their area is totally different from what we got here. And I think if we should do it right, the study should be done within Wicomico County instead of taking studies that were done 10, 15 years from some other state that doesn't have any kind of, their area doesn't even look like ours. That's how I feel.
Thank you, Councilman Davis. Any other council comments? Under presidential comments, in reference to the signing up, President Ashanti, we thought we'd try it. Some people had come to me before and said, John, your meetings are out of control. You know, people get up there, they speak forever. You never know when it's going to end. You know, I'm not going to the meeting because I never know when I'm going to get out. So I thought we'd try to add some type of, you know, structure to it. I agree it's a little too structured. I have no problem going back to the regular format that we've done before. I know you have to sign up when you speak with the city council. So I didn't think it was really being, too bad of an idea. But I can see just by how the evening went that I like the free flow as well. President Ashanti, I don't know where you are over there, but there you are. Okay. So I appreciate your comments always when you come to the podium. Thank you very much. In reference to the legislative bill, I think that we have come to a decision which was a fair bill. I think it was a good compromise between the poultry industry and the communities that were most impacted by the poultry industries and these poultry houses. When this first came up, I approached Jack Lennox. I said, Jack, can you give me an idea of what our poultry regulations are now? And he kind of laughed and very, you know, how Jack's very subtle. He said, John, I can do that in like 3 or 4 words. 100-foot setbacks. I said, well, what's the rest of it? And he goes, 100-foot setbacks. So that's literally all Wicomico County had. So I think that this council has come a long way in finding a bill, a legislative bill, to put the restrictions in place that are necessary. Restrictions that I think are a good compromise between the poultry industry and those communities that are impacted. We've gone from 100 feet to 200 and 400-foot setbacks. We've created 3 rows of buffers, and we've restricted the building of the poultry houses in the metro core area, which I think is a plus. The health concerns, I do understand the health concerns in the community, and I think every council member here is concerned about that. I live in the agricultural district, so I'm subject to the same concerns as well. I have poultry houses about less than a half mile from my house. I'm not really concerned. I know I purchased my house in an agricultural district, and I live by the rules that are in the agricultural district. But still, I don't want to, you know, I wouldn't turn a deaf ear to those that are concerned. I read a lot of the reports that came in. I probably read 95% of the reports that came in. I prepared a document that I shared with some of the individuals, some who are here today, on some of the reports that I felt were terribly misleading. A lot of the reports, in many cases, would intermingle poultry data with data from pig farms and data from cattle farms, and I thought that was very, very, very disappointing to seeking information on the poultry industry and finding these what considered to be bona fide reports intermingling a lot of other statistics that I felt didn't really belong in a poultry industry report, because we were trying to get to the true facts of what were in front of us. I believe I said before at the Civic Center, the poultry industry's been here for 100 years, and I would really think that there would be more reports and more information that we had that would substantially demonstrate the concerns, health issues, should they be there. Not only that, but I've said before, you have the Maryland Department of the Environment, whether you like them or whether you don't. The Maryland Department of the Environment is here to oversee the runoff and the issues of our health concerns. If you're worried about the paleo channel, the Maryland Department of the Environment is established to oversee this industry. I called our health department, our local health department. I said, well, MDE, they only do inspections once every 5 years. What do you think the county could do? Could the county maybe establish an annual inspection policy? And the response that I got was, well, the state of Maryland oversees this industry, and the state of Maryland does not want local jurisdictions interceding with their authority. It didn't make sense. To me, it made perfect sense. You're not duplicating resources. You're not duplicating the cost as far as taxpayers' dollars are concerned. Maryland Department of the Environment is established to oversee the poultry industry, and that's what they want to do, and that's what we have to have the faith in that agency to do their job. Now, that's just the runoff. If you're looking for the emissions, and I understand the concerns, you smell ammonia, you can smell this odor, you say, that can't be good. I don't know how quickly it dissipates. I'm not quite sure of just the degree of the issue. But I know that some people, the cooking in the house, whether it's the husband or the wife that's cooking in the house, sometimes it might not smell that great by the time they burn the chicken or the beef. But I couldn't say it's toxic. It's a little light humor, so. But my point being is that any emissions that come out from the poultry industry, from chicken houses or anything to that degree, that's overseen by the Environmental Protection Agency. So you have another group that's overseeing this industry. You have the Maryland Department of the Environment, you have the Environmental Protection Agency that's overseeing these two groups. So, you know, my issue I felt for the county council was zoning, and that was our responsibility to make sure that we protected the communities as far as the zoning issue was concerned, by making sure we had proper setbacks, by making sure we had proper buffers. And that way we're trying to protect not only the health, but also the property values of those who are in the agricultural district. So I'd like to thank the council for all their efforts and everything that we've had to do in the last 9 months. I'd like to thank the community as well that contributed. I found it very worthwhile. I found it very challenging. But I do think that we've come to a close, and I feel very comfortable with where we are. So again, thank everybody for all their input and for being here tonight. That being said, I'd like to entertain a motion from council to adjourn so that we can go into open work session.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Meeting's adjourned. We'll take a 10-minute recess. 10 minutes.